Section 2, summarizing and graphing data, is on histograms. The key concept: while a frequency distribution is a useful tool for summarizing data and investigating the distribution of data, an even better tool is a histogram, which is a graph that is easier to interpret than a table of numbers. A histogram is a graph consisting of bars of equal width drawn adjacent to each other, unless there are gaps in the data. The horizontal scale represents classes of quantitative data values, and the vertical scale represents frequencies. The heights of the bars correspond to frequency values. The important uses of a histogram: visually displays the shape of the distribution of the data, shows the location of the center of the data, shows the spread of the data, and identifies outliers. Here's an example. We're going to take this frequency distribution, which is time in seconds for the classes and the frequency of the data point counts for those classes, and we're going to construct a histogram. To construct a histogram, you first start by drawing your horizontal and vertical axes. So let me go ahead and draw the horizontal axis, and I'm going to draw a vertical axis. And then I'm going to identify by labeling each of these axes, and I'll just write on the screen. The title of the graph will be McDonald's lunch service times. This is the same data set that we used in the last section. And then on the side will be the frequency, and on the horizontal axis, x-axis, will be the time in seconds. Now notice that my time doesn't start at 0, it actually starts at 75 seconds. So I'm going to show a little break in the graph, and I'm going to begin my count at 75. And then I'm going to continue with labeling with the lower class width, lower class limits of each of the classes. One of the other things I could do is I could use class midpoints, or I could write the entire class down on the horizontal axis. And then my frequency, my maximum frequency is 24. So if I count by fives, 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, I'll have enough vertical height to draw my bars. Then I notice that my frequency for the first class, 75 to 124, is 11, and 75 to 124 would rise just above the 10, and I would draw a bar for my first class. The second class frequency is 24. Remember, these are adjacent bars, so I would rise up to the 24 mark and draw the bar height. 175 to 224 is 10, which is going to be a little bit lower than class 1, so at the 10. And then 3 for the next class for a frequency, and then 2 for the last class. So it does look like I probably want to make a mark for 325 just so I can get that last class. There is a histogram. A relative frequency histogram has the same shape and horizontal scale as a histogram, but the vertical scale is marked with relative frequencies instead of actual frequencies, representing the proportion as a percent or a decimal equivalent. This is our time in seconds for our McDonald's lunch service times. Our frequency listed as a count. If I want to construct a relative frequency distribution, I have to have the relative frequency of the service times. So I'm going to insert another column in order to include the relative frequency times. See if I can get my next column to the right. And this will be, I'll just put percents here because we understand that to be what we want for relative frequency based on our discussion in the previous section. And then do you remember how to get the percentage? Now I'm going to represent these as percent. You could certainly represent these in their decimal equivalent form. In order to get the percentage or proportion each class represents of the total, I need to know the total frequency. And if memory serves, and this is the exact same data, then this should be 50, and it is. And then 11 divided by 50 is 22, so this would be 22%. 24 divided by 50 is 48, 10 divided by 50 is 20, 3 divided by 50 is 6, 2 divided by 50 is 4, and remember these are percentages. And then to draw my histogram, I again need a horizontal and a vertical axis. So I'm going to go ahead and get those in place. Horizontal and vertical axes. My title, and these do join by the way, and my title is going to be again, because it is the McDonald's time, it'll be McDonald's lunch service times. Times again in seconds across the bottom. Again, I have my break in the graph because I'm going to start at 75. This is like a just a little zigzag. This part right here, it just shows that I have a significant gap between 0 and my starting value for my lower class limit. And I'll just label these with lower class limits. Class boundaries would be nice. You'll see a big variety of uses of the labels for these. And then the frequency, okay, but remember I'm using percent on the side this time, so the relative frequency, and I need to get to 48. So 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. The bars for 75 to 124 inclusive, that would be up at 22. And then the next height would be 48. A little wobbly because I'm drawing them by hand. 20 for the next one. 6 and 4. So very similar in shape to the last histogram that we drew, then that's because it's the same data, just relative frequencies instead of frequencies. This is what we ended up with. You notice that they used class boundaries for the marks in between the bars, which is a little clearer, and that they began the x-axis scale at 74.5. But the distributions look the same in shape because they represent the same data. Here is a histogram that depicts the weights in grams of quarters, and we need to be able to read the graph. Now, once you graph a data set, it gets a little more challenging to interpret it because you use that individuality of the actual data points. But we should be able to read the graph, at least in an estimate in this case. So how many quarters are included in the data set? The data set includes, that looks like it's about 12 for the height of that bar. This one's right at 20. This looks like it's about maybe 8. This one's at 5. This one is at maybe 17. This one is a little bit higher than the other one, so maybe 13. And this one is a little bit lower than the 5, so maybe 4. And again, I've lost the original data, so I have to basically guess at what the frequencies were, 12 and 20 and 8, and then 5 and 17 and 13 and 4. So 79, and more likely it was 80, but I'll say 79 is a good estimate. Estimated quarters. The class width looks like it's 0.1, and that's grams. And if we wanted to talk about the gap, it may be a very similar argument or reason there's a gap as to the pennies problem. And that's because the composition of materials that were used to create quarters varied over the years, and depending on the years of quarters that were included in the count, it could certainly speak to that gap that's in between this set of quarters and that set of quarters.